in the presence of the Lord. Sam, let the piano be a bit low at the moment. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, hallelujah.
Amen.
I don't know what brought you here today. I don't either know all the hurt. I don't know the disappointments. I don't know the setbacks. I don't know the delay in your life. I don't know what are your expectations today. Maybe you came here with a heart full of problems. I have good news for you today.
Amen.
That God is bringing you out in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
The strength of this ministry, I'll be very honest with you, that God began to tell me is my declarations. He said, as you, I'll say that from the first day. I said, as you declare it. If you look very kingly, most of the testimonies are from declarations.
That's right.
Even the prophetic is not my, I'm just exercising the power of the prophetic because I'm in the fivefold ministries.
Oh, yes.
You have to do it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
God will manifest those gifts in you. Amen. But the strength of the ministry of anyone is what God tells them to do.
Oh, yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
You'll be the one to prophesy before the queen in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Not me. You'll be the one to prophesy in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And when they are taking you back home, man, you'll be surprised that they are going another route. They'll be taking you to that castle that they have ordained for you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That will speak for you all in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Some of us don't believe. That's why amen are in our throats.
Amen.
Go with me to Ephesians 1:17-18. Let us read and let your voices sound like thunder. I'll read verse 17. You'll read verse 18. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. Read verse 18, please. I pray.
The eyes of your understanding be enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what is the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
We need to adjust this projector. Doctor, please, we'll do that after service. Remember, we said that this month is a month of divine insight. And we said last fortnight that in order to get this divine insight, we must be hooked up to the word of God. We must be hooked up to the infallible word, to the immutable word, to the sovereign word, to the everlasting word of God. Today in this service, quickly, because we don't have time, we shall look at another principle we must apply in order to gain divine insight, and that is thanksgiving. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Go with me to Psalms 34:1-8. I read verse 1, read verse 2, and then we read verse 8 together. Hallelujah. If you have a Bible, read, because the projector, we have to adjust it. I read verse 1. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Read verse 2, please. Many of you don't have Bibles. Hallelujah. Psalms 34, verse 1 to 8. Read verse 2, is on the screen.
My soul shall make boast in the Lord.
The humble shall hear thereof and be glad.
You see that all this while has not been called a brother. You come to church without a Bible, I don't get it. It's like someone who is going to the farm will die for last. What are you going to chap with your hand? You chap them with your hand, with the grass with your hand. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let's take the things of God seriously. This is the second part of the year, and I don't want anyone to end this year without that heart desire of them coming to pass. Verse 3, I read, oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name forever. Read verse 4, please.
I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from all my fears.
Verse 5, I read, they looked unto him, that's talking about you and I, and were lighting. Well, they were, what were they looking at? They were looking at the word of God. They were reading the word of God. And their faces were not ashamed. That tells you that every time you plant your head on the word of God, shame is counsel. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Read the next verse, please.
This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him. I saved him out of all his trouble.
Why did the Lord save him out of all his trouble? Because he ate the word. So the Lord saw that and saved him from all his trouble. Verse 7, the angel of the Lord encamped round about them that fear him and delivered them. Hallelujah. Verse 8.
Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusted.
Blessed is the man that trusted in the Lord. Blessed is the man that giveth thanks on the Lord. Indirectly, that's what it says. So it means that your restoration is in your thanksgiving. It means that your deliverance is in your thanksgiving. It means that your next level blessings is in your thanksgiving. Everything that you require from the Lord is in your thanksgiving. Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And thanksgiving is what you do daily. Not just when that check comes through. Not just when that wife comes through. Not just when that breakthrough comes through. Not just every day I give thanks. Every day. Thank you, Jesus. That, you think I don't have a problem? I have a problem. All of you, join all your problems together. Mine is bigger than yours. But I said, Lord, I refuse to look at my problem. I look unto you. From where cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord, which maketh heaven and the earth.
Hallelujah.
Being faithful does not mean you will not go to trials. Being faithful to God does not eliminate adversaries. And there is a great and effectual door. But there are many adversaries. Does it just say to your unbelievers? No. The rain falleth on the just and the unjust. The only difference between you and the unbeliever is that the grace speaks for you. The grace restores you. The grace gives you peace. The grace gives you hope. The grace gives you faith that God who said it will surely bring it to pass. Hallelujah. I prophesy in the name of Jesus that that miracle starts now in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Most often you may not do everything right, but your thanksgiving will fight for you. You wonder why David fought all 66 battles and won all. Because David will praise God in the morning. David will praise God in the afternoon. David will praise God in the evening. In fact, one verse says, David praised God 7 times a day.
Oh, yes.
A king with all the burdens, with all the troubles, with all the problems, with all the vice on his table, David still find time to praise the Lord. Any of us say, I don't have time. What do you have time for? It means you're not using your time rightly. Because all of us have 24 hours a day. Nobody has 25 hours. But it is discipline. It is setting your priority right that sets you apart. This month, God will set you apart in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Friends, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Bless the Lord at all times, David said. Honor and give him thanks in the middle of the storm.
Oh, yes.
The truth is that your thanksgiving will give the enemy, will keep the enemy off you. You can resist the devil by your consistent thanksgiving. Every day you wake up in the morning and say, I look good, because this day is a day that the Lord has made. I will therefore rejoice and be glad in it. In the camp of the enemy, they're having a heart attack. This one that I want to kill, he's looking at himself and saying, it's good that I want to destroy that body of his. And God is in heaven. He is so happy that this is my son. And he's in a hurry to bring down the testimonies. You will not miss your testimonies after this morning in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
I say this month of August is a thanksgiving month. None will miss their testimonies in the mighty name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Friends, God sent me here today to tell someone to stop trying to figure things out. How God is going to do it, some of us even have our books. Some of us are watching TV and we see someone won the lottery and we start calculating. Say this 16 million is so what? Say if it was me, I'll buy the house. Some of us will go to the internet and be checking the house that we'll buy with someone else's money, hallelujah, instead of thanking God for our own.
Yes.
God can bless you in a million times. Don't check it. No. God can bless you in a million times. The person that said had immigration breakthrough this week was not, in fact, they gave him above what he was expecting. Go now and apply for your British citizenship. Normally, it takes 1 year after your indefinitely to remain to apply for citizenship, British citizen. But they say, go now and apply. Because this is someone who was thankful. This is someone who said, though he slain me, yet will I trust him even more. Yet will I thank him even more. Proverbs 21:1 says, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. As the rivers of water, he turns turneth them wheresoever he will. He turneth them wheresoever he will. So I prophesy that the remainder of this year, God will pay off all your debts in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I see everywhere your name is being written as a debtor. My God, I have angels walking with me. I send them on errand now to that office, and I command them to wipe off that debt in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say this month you will receive a letter saying that we are happy to announce to you that your debts has been canceled in the mighty name of Jesus. I don't know who has taken counsel to bring you down. It shall not stand in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say neither shall it come to pass in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I prophesy that it does not matter who has gone ahead of you. Receive the anointing to overtake now in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say receive the anointing to overtake now in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You know when we just came to this country, simple getting village passports. And it's like they're even provoking you. They're even provoking you. Because they'll say in front of you, you know, us that we have this British passport. British passport without job. British passport without nothing. No other evidence. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But when your own comes, it will come with a bundle. It will come with a check. It will come with an apology. That will be your story in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Today, many are in churches 24/7, but their lives is in the, it's a life of questions. They are asking so many questions instead of thanking God. They are asking so many questions instead of thanking God. Why am I not married? Why am I so broke? Why do I have an overdraft? Why has my breakthroughs not come? Why have I not got children? Why did I, who did I offend? Who did I offend? Why are these battles not ending? They forget that many others are praying to be in their shoe.
Oh, yes.
My brother, oh, yes. Where you are now? There are a lot of people on a queue praying to be like you. So instead of mourning, what do? You thank God. Say, God, I may not be where I want to be, but I thank you because I am where you want me to be. Hallelujah.
Amen.
They are mourning that they don't have a pair of shoes to come to church, but someone has no legs to come to wear a pair of shoes. They are mourning that they don't have a car to come to church, but someone else had a car and had an accident. Hallelujah. Instead of thanking God, say, God, though I don't have a car, but at least I don't have an accident. God, though I don't have money, but at least I am righteous. And I know that you'll bring it to pass according to your will. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Friends, you might think you are a failure, but many people are praying to be like you. So do not kill yourself. Learn to thank God for where you are instead of money. I prophesy that your settlement is confirmed by this encounter in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say your job is confirmed in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say your lifting is confirmed in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say your promotion is confirmed in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Some of you looking at me right now, tonight an angel will so visit you and will give you that business idea.
Amen.
That you have been crying out for.
Amen.
And that will be generational blessing in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
After this encounter, I celebrate you.
Amen.
God will announce you to your generation in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say anything about your life that said you were stagnated before, I see accelerated speed in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Wherever you are, I release the spirit of miracles in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I release the spirit of breakthroughs in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Today, when you tell people to thank God instead of complain about their situation, they will tell you, Pastor, you do not know what I am going through. Pastor, you do not know what I've been through. Pastor, you do not know what I will be through. But God is watching from heaven and saying, I wish they knew. God, Jesus looked at Jerusalem and began to cry. Why? Because he looked at them. He said that if these people only knew who they are. That's why I was weeping. Say, Jerusalem, healthy, big, prosperous nation. But the people are being destroyed. Why? Because of ignorance. Go with me to John 11:41-43. John 11:41-43. We see the Savior here. We see Jehovah Nissi here. We see Jesus, the mediator, that is confronted with a situation. He is facing an affliction on every side. But he made made up his mind to give thanks unto the Lord. John 11, 41. Let's read from 41. Read 41 or read 42.
Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me.
I read 42. And I knew that thou hearest me always. But because of the people who stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. 43, please. And when
Jesus had spoken, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth.
How can a man who is faced with a deadly situation, he said, thank God. I saw you that earlier in the announcement. How can he thank God? Because he knew that thanksgiving was what he needed to begin to bring forth Lazarus from the grave. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Look at Jesus again, who has been confronted with another situation where he was meant to feed 5,000 men, including women and children. And the first thing he said is, Father, I thank you. Jesus, they need food now. And all he said, Father, I thank you. As soon as he said, Father, I thank you, food began to increase. At the end of the day, the Bible says that they took off, I think it's 12 baskets. That one, 12 more baskets full. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Because Jesus understood that thanksgiving invokes testimony. So it is simple common sense to thank God when he has favored you. Notice that anything you thank God for, you are indirectly inviting him to act in that situation. You thank God for that immigration breakthrough. You are telling Jehovah Nissi, Jehovah Yahweh, Jehovah Makadesh that appear at the home office. When you thank Jehovah Jireh for that car, you are telling him that touch the heart of this man to buy me a new car. When you thank Jehovah Jireh for food, I had no car or had a key. One month in the country, no car, key in my hands. Car, come here for me. Jesus, I thank you for the car. It is coming now. Hallelujah. And eventually, the car came after 3 months. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Why? Because of thanksgiving. I have said it again several times that in this kingdom, you give thanks to God before something happens. In the other kingdom, they give you something before you say thank you. So we cannot begin to walk like the canal man on the street. So you do not wait for things to happen before you thank God. You thank God before they happen. That is why many have been waiting for years when nothing is happening, because they have refused to do the right thing. What is the right thing? Giving thanks to God. To wait for everything to be perfect before giving thanks to God is to end up in destruction. Because I always say that if a man say, oh, I don't have much, so I cannot give anything. Even when you have 1 million, you don't give. Because you start giving from the 10 pounds you have, hallelujah.
Oh, yeah.
You say, okay, this 10 pound, 1 pound belongs to God. And then God looks at you and says, no, this one is following divine principles, and he begins to bless you. God is blessing someone as I speak in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say, God is blessing someone as I speak in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So right now you want a house, you thank God for the house. Right now you want an interview, a job, you thank God for the job. Right now you go for an interview and they say, sorry. You raise up the thing and say, God, I thank you because I know you're walking behind the scene on my behalf. Thank you, that's all what he wants to hear. Many times we keep praying for the same thing and the same thing instead of thanking God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thanksgiving invokes testimonies. Thank God that you have the immigration breakthrough, like I said, before it happens. When you thank God, you are saying God over to you. Philippians 4, 8 to 6 says, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made unto God. I come here, I see 2 people, ask my wife. We go back home, Father, we thank you. Like for 2-3 minutes, we are still thanking him. Father, we thank you. I go back upstairs to my room. Lord, I thank you. 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 You keep thanking him. And God begins to gather the testimonies in your favor. That is how it works. So that tells you that from that verse, Philippians 4, 6 to 8, that your prayers and thanksgiving are in the same category.
Oh, yeah.
Thanksgiving is the shortest form of prayer. Even at work, if you are too busy, you cannot pray. Just say, God, I thank you.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you for protecting me. Like I said, if God will open our eyes every time to see the protection, the grace working for us while we are out there, we will begin to thank God every single second.
Oh, yeah.
Thanksgiving is the shortest form of prayer. Many of you have still not received what your heart desires, because you are not taking time to thank God well, but you are taking good time to complain. You are taking all the time to complain. No, this shoe is not good. No, this dress is not good. No, this is not good. Instead of thanking God for what He has given us. Touch your neighbor and say, stop complaining, stop complaining, stop complaining, stop complaining, stop complaining. God showed me something this week and I was like, wow. God showed me something this week and I was like, wow. And He said to me that instead of complaining about the children, begin to thank God for them. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And He said to me that many are in churches that what is happening is that their children are arrogant, they are swearing, they are rude, they don't care about anybody because they saw it somewhere. Hallelujah.
Oh, yes.
I'll tell you, He told me, I was writing it down, because they saw it somewhere. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I always say that you are the book, you are the picture that your children are looking at. Does that make sense? You are the book, you and I are the book that they are reading. So what we make sure we do is that they are reading the right book, that they are looking at the right picture. If you notice very well, in most families, like they say, like father, like son, like mother, like son, or like daughter. Why? Because those things that you do that you think you are so right, but that you know in your heart that it goes against the will of God, those children are watching. You are fighting with your wife, you are fighting with your husband, they might act as if they are sleeping, they are not sleeping, nothing. They are listening, they are watching. You are watching TV and a sexual scream comes up and you don't have the common courtesy to put it off in front of the children. You are now watching all those soaps in front of them. You are now watching all those dramas in front of them. And God began to tell me that they are watching at that. And when they grow up, they think that that is acceptable because my father was watching me, because my mother was watching it. You are lying in front of the children. They are watching. And God began to tell me that when they grow up, they begin to lie. And you begin to whip them. And you begin to tell them things. They got it from who? From you. I began to write all this down. You are the book your children are reading. If you want your children to be prayerful children, let them see you pray. Sir, let them see you pray. You want them to read the Bible, to dwell on the things of God, let them see it from you first. They will not learn anything else apart from what you are teaching them, apart from the picture that you are showing them. If you tell them that drama on TV is okay, they will take it as something that is acceptable in society. If you think that they are not listening, they are listening to the swearing. They are listening to that young man on TV talking to the mother anyhow, swearing, saying nasty things. And one day you sit down and they begin to say the same thing. And you say, where did you learn that from? No, ma. No, sir. They learned it at home. Not at school.
Oh, yes.
They learned it at home. Make sure our children are watching the right picture. Because the picture they see in the inside of you and in the inside of me is what determines how their life, how their destiny will look like. Does that make sense?
Yes. Oh, yes.
You are watching something that is not good and your kids are there. Put it off. Put it off. Let them watch TV. Let them watch Papa preaching. Whoever is preaching, let them begin to hear. Let the word of God, as it is entering you, is entering them. And you think they are not hearing. They are hearing. If you watch TV and you are watching those worldly people dancing anyhow, you start seeing them dancing and you are wondering, where did you get this from? They got their home from watching TV. They got their home from what you are doing. Hallelujah.
Amen.
If your kids, they see that you are not dwelling in the presence of the Lord, they know that, okay, it's okay to just sleep the papa, to just sleep the mama, to just do what they are, because they are watching. So they are copying. They are copying exactly what you are doing. God began to teach me now this week. Say, we should all make sure, including me, that we should all make sure that we are teaching our children what we want them to become. That we are making them see what we want them to become. Let them see it in us. It is from your watching that insane TV drama program in their presence that begin to make them swear and begin to act arrogant in the house. It is from your quarreling with that person, your next door neighbor, in front of them, that begins to make them go to school and begin to fight. And they bring a complaint back home that your children fought with the other child. And you say, where did you get that from? No, ma. No, ma. No, sir. She got it. He got it from the house. At home. And they have now grown up to think that That is what my dad was doing. That is what my mom was doing. That is what they were watching. And that is what is acceptable in the society. The truth is that if you have a fasting father, you are a fasting mother, and your children are watching, and they will become fasting children. If you are a prayerful one, they will become prayerful children. If you read your Bible daily, I've said it already, they will read their Bibles daily. If you are a liar, they will be liars. That will not be our story in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. So let us live the life we want for our children. That was just something I heard this week. I said, I should share with you. If you are blessed, God for Jesus. I carry on my preaching. You know, for me, it is still a wonder to me why people focus more on what God has not done than what God has already done for them. I said, Noah built an ark, and the Lord said to Noah, make sure the window is on top. God, windows are the side now. But he said to Noah, build a window on top of that ark. Why? Because so that when there is a problem, when Noah is faced with any affliction, when Noah needs any help, he can look up to the Lord, to the heavens, from where his help will come.
Oh yes.
Not by the side. By the side, you'll see man. Not by the left, because there again, you'll see man. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You may have had many miscarriages. You may have had many failures. You may have had many disappointments at the age of your breakthrough. But thank God you are still alive. You still have the capacity to have more children. You still have the capacity to have more breakthroughs. You still have the capacity for another woman to come into your life. You still have the capacity. You are alive for another man to come in your life. Yes, that man or that woman may have left you, but thank God that you still have two legs to apply for another man to apply to get married to you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
It does not matter what you're going through now. Thank God for what he has already done. Numbers 21, it says, and the Lord said unto Moses, make thee a fairy serpent and set it upon a pole, and it shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, what will happen? He shall live. That tells you that your solution will come speedily when you take your eyes off the problem and onto God. Your solution will come speedily. Your blessings will come speedily when you take your eyes off that problem and look unto God and God alone. Because when you keep focusing on the situation, you miss the solution. Psalms 23, 4 says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, yet will I fear no evil. So whatever you are going through now is just a transition. And so look up to Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. Hebrews 12:2, looking up to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus was nailed at the cross, but all he saw was heaven. He said, and I see myself seated on the right side of God. He was not bothered about the pain. He was not bothered about the shame. They mocked at him. They spit at him. They cursed him. They said, you said you are the Messiah. Perform miracle now and leave that cross. Jesus never bothered about what they were saying. Jesus looked at nothing but the cross. And prophet Isaiah went up to King Hezekiah and said, King, set your house in order. You will die and not live. As soon as he delivered the message, he turned his back and he went back out of the palace. Now, what was King Hezekiah do? The Bible says that King Hezekiah forgot about the most important prophet of the time, the greatest prophet of the time. The Bible says that he turned his face to the wall and looked up to the cross from where coming itself. And the Bible says that as he began to thank God, and as he began to remind God of every promise that God has said about him, he said, God, if I die tomorrow, who will save you? Who will bless you? Who will give you thanks? That's what he said. And the Bible says that before prophet Isaiah could go out of the palace, the Lord said to prophet Isaiah, go back and tell him that I've added more years to his age. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thanksgiving invokes testimonies. We don't just say we do it. This last time I went to my father and I said, Father, this is an envelope, hundreds of pounds. I'm saying that now, my wife doesn't even know I'm in trouble today. I'm really joking. Hallelujah. Many Christians are so carnal these days, and the truth is that they do not even know it. Many go through the least challenge, and instead of thanking God that they are alive, they are instead offended with God. Matthew 11:6 says, "And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me." That is Jesus speaking. God is in heaven. He doeth whatever he pleases. We cannot take him to God. So instead of mourning, instead of complaining, thank God. You might be delayed, but you will be the latest in the name of Jesus. Amen. We live in a society where Christians don't want to go through anything. That breakthrough now. If it doesn't happen, they look around. They see the other person getting their breakthroughs. They say, "God, what did I do to you? Why me? Who did you want it to be?" Hallelujah.
Amen.
For God maketh all things beautiful in his own time. We live in a generation where many Christians go through the least challenge, and instead of thanking God, all they think about is to backslide. Who are you fooling? I've said it again and again. I say, if you don't come to church, nobody will miss you. That's the truth. Maybe human like us might miss you, but God will not miss you. Does that make sense?
Amen.
God will call you. Hallelujah. We'll call you wherever you one, twice we'll call you after that. But God will not miss you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I want you all to know that God is not at a loss if you do not come to church again. If you are offended by him, if you think he's too slow. As a matter of fact, these days, those who are in the world are looking for how to enter the church. You know, they've done so many terrible things in the world, and everybody already knows them. Now, they don't know how they'll get into the church. They are looking at how to enter into the church. Because whether you know it or not, whether they like it or not, most of them know that Jesus is alive. Most of them know that he's coming back. Most of them know that there is a heaven and earth. Someone came to me the other day and said something. I said, "This is the reason why I'm not going to church." I said, "If you go or you don't go, heaven is real. Hell is real. If you miss hell, you will not miss heaven. If you miss heaven, you will not miss hell." And he began to say, "Oh." That was it for him. Hallelujah. Friends, only those who have a head to think world will use that head world to thank God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The Bible says, "Don't be weary because you shall reap in due time." So that tells you that the times of affliction are not times of comfort. But what you do at that time is thank God, because God is turning that mess into a miracle in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
We live in a generation of Christians who do not want to go through any form of hardship at all. Christians who do not want to hear anything called trials. Christians who have zero records before God. Zero records before God. God never delayed something and expected and saw them patient enough to wait for God to bring their manifestation into being without complaining, without murmuring, without saying all sort of things. Touch your neighbor and say, "What is your record? What is your record before God? What have you been through because of the gospel? What have you been through because of the things of God? What have you been through because of the kingdom of the Lord?" Why Goliath was mocking the children of Israel on the battleground for 40 days and 40 nights. Only one man stood up. Only when they all thought that it was impossible to kill Goliath, David showed forth. The Bible says that Goliath was 16 foot. David was only 4 feet. And he showed forth and he said, "Who is this on second star Philistine to defy the armies of the living God?" That's what David said. They said to David that, "You will die now, Only one punch, if I kill you so badly." A man whose armor was bigger than the living. His armor was that big. They gave David an armor. He could not walk. It was too big for him. But David said, "I cannot." You know my record. The Lord helped me, I kill a bear. Now, he was giving his record. What have you done for God? What is your record before God? David said, "I can kill Goliath." And they asked him, "What makes you think you can kill this giant?" And he answered, "Because I have records." David said, you can see from my records that Goliath is a nonentity. Sir, I don't need your armor. I need a stone. A stone is used to kill birds. David took it to kill a giant. Hallelujah. That is the confidence we have in him. That whatever we say, he says he will do. Blessed is he that believeth in the Lord. For there shall be a performance of those things that are said of him by the Lord. But what is the thing? You must be still and know that he is Lord. So that tells you in Matthew 25, it says that the bridegroom tarried while the virgin was sat down waiting for him. So that tells you that there is a time when God tarries, even after your prayers. And what you do at that time is to thank him. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hannah kept going to Shiloh. Hannah kept going to Shiloh. She said, although there is no evidence to show, I will keep going. I'll keep going to thank God. Hannah, what is happening with you? They are, your concubine had 10 kids. You had none. And Hannah said, yes, I know I don't have any, but I'll keep going to give thanks to God. And when God showed up, what happened? The one that she got, Samuel, was more than the ten of the concubines combined together. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That is to tell you the power of thanksgiving. I prophesy that from today, as you make thanksgiving your lifestyle, your life will no longer be an explanation, but your life will be an exclamation in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say your life will be manifestation Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say from January to December, you manifest the power of God in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You manifest the presence of God in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
As you make thanksgiving your lifestyle, after now, wherever you are, wherever you go, doors will be open for you in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
I see open doors in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
As I end this sermon with Psalms 103 verse 1 to 5, let's read together. Psalms 103 verse 1 to 5. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Are we there? Yeah. 4, 3, 2, read. Psalms 103 verse 1 to 5. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name, and all that is within me. Not just say thank you, Jesus, and the next thing you go outside, you're crying. Oh, that letter did not come today. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Verse 2, please. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. You see, there's a repetition here. You think it's tautology, it's not tautology. The Bible, every word in the Bible are guaranteed promises. Verse 3, please. Who forgiveth all thy iniquities? Who healeth all thy diseases? Verse 4, please.
Who
redeemeth thy life from destruction? Who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies? Verse 5, verse 2 together. Who satisfies thy mouth with good things so that thy youth is renewed like the eagle? What does that mean if God is satisfying your mouth with good things? It means that everything that comes out of your mouth after that will be good.
Oh, yes.
Does that make sense? Everything that comes out of your mouth after that will be thanksgiving.
Oh.
Everything that comes out of your mouth after that will be, Lord, I bless you with all my heart. Stand up on your feet in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Stand up on your feet and thank God for what came for today. Lord, we celebrate you. Lord, we bless you. Lord, I bless you. Lord, I bless you. Lord, I bless you. Lord, I celebrate you. Lord, I thank you for the word that came for today. Thank you and thank you and thank you and thank you and thank you. Thank you and thank you and thank you and thank you. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Let's pray a short prayer as we run out of time. Let's say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you baptize me with the spirit of thanksgiving. Open your mouth and pray. Baptize me with the spirit of thanksgiving. Baptize me with the spirit of thanksgiving. Baptize me with the spirit of thanksgiving, O Lord. That no matter what I see, no matter what I face, O Lord, let my mouth thank you for the things that you've done, not for the things that I've not yet seen. For your glory, O Lord. In the name of Jesus. Marco Tene Kese Malaka. Father, we just thank you. Lord, we just celebrate you. Lord, we just rejoice you. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Lift those hands as I release a prophetic blessing. Friends, every affliction has an expiring day. The Bible says that as it came, it left. As he came, he left. So I decree upon you by this encounter, every affliction is terminated now in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I say, as you enter this month of August 2017, God has taken over your battles in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I decree and I declare that from now your kingdom authority is established in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I decree that as you enter this new month, God will deliver that good news into your hands in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I said that long awaited testimonies, God is releasing it into your hands in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Everyone here set for a miracle job, go and take it now in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I pray for you, whoever is hiding behind the mask, better they are attackers of your destiny. Today I take off their mask by the fire of the Holy Ghost and I command them to confess and expire in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
No matter the thickness of the smoke, it is controlled by the winds. Therefore, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, I release the wind of the Holy Ghost over all the powers of darkness fighting you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let the will of God prevail in your life in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let the will of God prevail in your marriage in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let the will of God prevail in your career in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I decree that God will keep you and your family in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
He will preserve you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
It is done in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Clap those hands for Jesus and thank you for your prayer. Lord, we just celebrate you. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying.
Amen.
Amen.
In the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us now and forever.
Surely, God's goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our life, and we shall dwell in the presence of the Lord forever and ever.
Amen.
Go to your neighbor and say, I cannot wait for you to testify on Thursday, on Friday, on Sunday. This Thursday, Friday, Sunday for services. Hallelujah.
I cannot wait for you to testify.